the world that we're picking up from the last movie is a world wherein superheroes do exist, but they are illegal because of various things, one of which is when they have a battle, who pays for all the damage? And I guess some, you could presume some things got out of hand and there were court cases, et cetera. And it's best for the government, less expensive, less problematic, if they just make superheroing illegal. And all of the superheroes that existed and are still alive and kicking are forced underground, like a witness relocation program. So they're forced to have normal lives on the outside, get jobs, hide their powers. And that's the world that the first movie existed in and that we're reigniting with this one. The audience knows from the first film that Jack-Jack, who we previously thought had no powers and was the only normal member of the family, actually has multiple powers. Now the audience knows that, but the Incredibles don't know that. The Parrs don't know that. So Bob, Helen, and Dash and Violet have no idea that their brother, a little brother, has more powers, an assortment of them. He's kind of a Swiss Army knife of powers than any other member of the family. And so this movie picks up, and this movie, they become aware of that fact. And they become aware of it at the worst time possible, when Helen is out doing hero work and Bob is in charge of the family. Incredibles 2 has two new characters that are major characters in this film, Winston Dever and his sister Evelyn. And they inherit their father's sort of electronics company. They, instead of just being people that collect the money, they actively run the company. And Winston is sort of the company guy, and Evelyn comes up with technical things, developments and breakthroughs that they can then commercially adapt. And so they've not just inherited the father's company, they've made the company far bigger and more successful. Probably the first idea I had about this movie was right on the heels of the original movie. And that was that I wondered how Bob would take it if his wife got the assignment rather than him. I think it is incomprehensible to him that that would ever be a logical choice. And it's not because he thinks poorly of his wife. It's because he thinks he so believes in his own abilities. And he thinks it's so apparent to everyone the way it is to him. One of the pleasures of doing this film was that, unlike the first film, I had not only gotten my dream guys, my dream cast, but I had also worked with them before. So I knew how much fun it was, and that, you know, they can go anywhere you need them to go. And it was wonderful to return to working with Craig and Holly and Sam and Sarah and all of the voices in this film. Giacchino was one of the big discoveries for me. He's such a versatile talent. He can do any sound under the sun. And so I've used him on every movie since, because he brings a unique perspective to it. And I almost think about him like another character or another actor on the film, because he's interpreting the story and he has a very good storytelling sense. So his music always has a storytelling aspect to it. And it doesn't mean that you echo whatever feeling is on the screen. Sometimes you go counter to what's on the screen, but it's a dance, and he is a very good dancer. You know, he weaves himself through the many aspects of character and story, and I really look at him like I look at a lot of my collaborators as co-storytellers, you know, and I love working with Michael.